Hi guys, hope everyone is okay. It's been a while, it's been a minute. Hope everyone is doing fine and doing lovely. Well, welcome to this other episode of Out of Bounds with me, Marion. With me today is someone who's already featured on the show. Prior to their visit to Namibia, we caught up with the cricket crane's coach, Lawrence Mahatlane, as he told us his ambitions for the national team, his expectations from that trip in Namibia. Well, Uganda went to Namibia and things didn't quite go well. We didn't get any win from there. We're here to find out from coach his honest opinion and his assessment of the tour. Coach, let's just get straight to it. The trip to Namibia was the first time the cricket crane actually had a tour in over 2 years. Give us your honest assessment of that tour.
Yeah, I think firstly, from a cricket point of view, the results were very disappointing at the way they happened. So for me, if I look at the first T20, we played within 24 hours of arriving in the country. We got blown out of the water. Second T20, I thought we were on top of the game. You know, having bowled them out for 135, we're well set. Unfortunately, lost way too many wickets. So when the rain came down, we lost by 20 runs on the Duckworth-Lewis system. And individually and at certain moments, there were good performances. But as a team, we just never gelled and put performance consistently throughout the games.
Aside from obviously the performance that wasn't really up there, were there any positives you think?
Yeah, I think if you look at just some of the figures, you look at some of the way the guys bounce back. I look at young Cosmos, how first game he was really under pressure, second game he bowled 4 overs for 12. So how guys were able to grow within the tour, I think that was important. And from our side, also understanding what ODI cricket is all about. You know, Namibia are going to the T20 World Cup. They must be rated in the top, where we 32nd. And in one day cricket, they're an ODI side, like I said in the last interview. And they showed why. I think the big difference between the two teams was one, consistency. And the second one was when we had them under pressure, they were able to come out of it and bounce back well. When they got us under pressure, they never let go. So those are the two areas that really stood out for me on this tour.
In the current times, I think about every sport, if you're going to play tournament or whatever, it's about a bubble. Describe for us the experience. Usually players love to unwind, after the game, stress and all that, they need to shed off the stress and all. Given you're under a bubble, how a player is able to cope up with that?
Yeah, it is tough. It is unusual times in the world. It is tough that you're always in each other's space. At no stage do you get away from each other. And given the duration of the tour as well, we got into camp for 3 days straight from camp. We then went on a tour. So 15 days together in the same place. Very limited in what we can do is challenging, and these are part of the lessons, you know, because going to Jersey, we might be in a bubble, and having experienced it before from our side in terms of how to manage it, how to get certain things in place to make sure that it doesn't become monotonous.
I wish it was a good day. Last time we spoke, you were very optimistic about the results, rather the process. You know, so much to the process and all that. But so Ugandans, we're not patient for it. We're very ambitious. Was Namibia a reality for you, or are you already feeling the system?
I think it was a reality check for the system. I think we know where we want to go. We want to achieve ODI status. That's our vision. That's our goal. And we had to check where we are comparatively to the guys that are already in that part. So I think pressure, I always believe pressure is a privilege. And if you don't feel it while representing your country, then you shouldn't be representing your country. So I'm honored to be under the pressure, because as a country we deserve positive results. And I think, as you said, part of the process is to make sure that we get those positive results, but not only in the short term, making sure that those positive results can last for years to come. You know, one of the hardest things is when we win in Jersey and in Uganda at qualify, we still have to go play a qualifying tournament to maintain ODI status for at least 3 years. So Namibia at the moment are ranked 18th, so they could be in that tournament. USA are ranked 19th, they could be in that tournament. Papua New Guinea is ranked 20th, they could be in that tournament. And Nepal are ranked 17th. So we could be in a tournament for 2 weeks against those four nations. So if we don't know what they're doing and how they are doing, we might arrive and say, oh, we were unlucky. Now we know what they do, and we can prepare accordingly. It might not happen in the next year. It might only happen in 2023 March, but it's better you know where you're going, what you're trying to achieve, than putting our heads in the sand.
Oh, well, Namibia is obviously an ODI nation. They defeated the SA United side. A side that has the players coached in the under-19 team. What lessons do you pick up from Namibia?
Yeah, I think they're very professional. I think from everything they do, they're a very professional outfit, and you can see it from just the way they dress, the way they carry themselves, the kind of systems they've got in place in terms of their support staff, the full-time support staff around the national team. All those programs, all those are dreams of ours to hopefully attain and make sure that we stay in one day cricket. So it's just beyond the cricket. It's everything else in terms of how the systems are in place and how they run things that hopefully we learn from.
Well, the cricket craves yet to show a style of play. Yeah, as a coach, what kind of style would you love cricket, Uganda cricket craves to be known for? Are we a batting tail, maybe bowling?
Yeah, I think. Yeah, I think over the years, fielding has been a big issue. We've been known as athletic team, a team that fields well. We've been known as a team of fighters, guys that if they can get 180 can scrape and really fight and stay in the competition, stay in the moment. I'd like to see us grow as a batting unit. I think our bowling and our fielding is things that can be controlled, and through passion, through practice we can get. My big drive over this, my tenure as coach, is to really get batters to get Ugandan batters to score hundreds. You know, the fact that Ronak managed to score 100 against an ODI side just psychologically says, I'm capable of scoring 100 in ODI cricket. And that for me was massive tick, and hoping that more players can get into that position.
Obviously, Namibia has to be our reference. How far do you think Uganda is what needs to be done first to get to that?
I don't think we're that far apart. I think sometimes, I think all the time, results don't really reflect. I think natural ability, we well ahead. But in terms of discipline and consistency, they're well ahead. And if we can get our natural ability to become more consistent and a bit more disciplined in our skills, I believe that we can achieve this dream of becoming an ODI team.
So you're saying we're much talented than Namibian side?
Guys are good athletes. I look at some of these young guys, they all can hit to a ball 100 meters. They're all athletics. It's about doing it consistently. It's about mentally getting into a space and understanding that they need to get through pressure moments to go and express themselves instead of trying to hit ourselves out of a pressure moment. I think it was the first time that guys had faced a bowler at the pace of Ruben Trimpelman, for example, who was bowling at well over 140 Ks. How do we react to that? We didn't react very well to that, but it is part of those lessons to say, maybe facing 128 versus 140, I can be a bit tighter. So I think that it's easier when you give it as a lecture, but once you experience it, you start owning that process a bit better.
I'm very sure you're banking on certain players shining in this year. If you look at the individual performances, way disappointed by some distance, individual.
Yeah, I think again, you know, one of the hardest things, firstly, losing the captain the day before the tour obviously sets us on the back foot. But again, having seen individuals, you can only understand and learn individuals once you've seen them under real pressure. So expectation versus reality, there were a couple of challenges, and hopefully we can change those around in the next couple of months.
So after Namibia, where do you want to take your trips? Obviously before Jazeera, where do you want to take your trips?
Yeah, we're hoping to be hosting Takashinga in the next couple of months. You know, they're a very good team. They've had a lot of players that have played for Zimbabwe and Zimbabwe A. And they've beaten us before here in Uganda, so it will be a good challenge for us to see how far we've come. That's one. And for me, it's just about us getting our processes right. We're planning to arrive in Jersey a bit earlier than most, not only to acclimatize, but to also play a couple of warm-up games. And through that, hopefully we can get our performances going.
Can you maybe give us a perspective on how the process should work? And I'd love you to mention maybe a player you think will be a big thing in years to come.
Yeah, I think there are a lot of good kids. I think there are a lot of, and maybe let me pick a player who we took to Namibia, Cosmos. So Cosmos is a youngster, he's 20 years old. It was his first tour, first game, really didn't bowl well. Bowled well in the next couple of games. It's again about how do we balance giving him the experience of experiencing international cricket, but also having a senior bowler around him to make sure that his growth gets accelerated. So for me, that's where the process is about exposing the youngsters, but not only completely going with the youngsters, because they need to learn from some kind of experience. So getting that balance is, I think that's the art and skill of coaching.
Zephania is a fan favorite, yeah, but he's been frozen out, even by you. What's the thing with him?
Nobody gets frozen out. I think, again, it's just through performances. Guys obviously got Uganda contracts, A contracts, and I think Zeph has grown a lot in the last couple of months since I've been here. I've been really impressed with his growth. If I look at his performances over the last couple of weeks, where he has made an 80, he's made a couple of 40s, he's starting to understand that it's not only about the image and the off-field and the entertainment, but it's also about getting into a space where performance on a consistent basis also counts. And I'm excited with that kind of youngster, because again, he's also in his 20s. He can play for this country for the next 10 years. And if he can learn those lessons now at a young age, by the time he gets into his 30s, he'll be a legend of the game in this country. So nobody gets frozen out or kicked out. Everybody is at a different time and different phase of developing.
Okay, after what you saw from Namibia, do you think, do you have some regrets about the job, or this is actually what you signed up for?
I think as a coach, that's what you sign up for. It is exciting. It's exciting to see growth, to see player growth. You know, I was doing a report the other day and I looked at how the guys have performed in club cricket in 2018-2019 season and how they're performing in internal games, to tell you that they've all improved by an average of about 10 runs in their batting processes. I know a lot of people think, they were averaging 10 to 20, but that is where the growth is happening. And the more we do this, with time, we'll get these youngsters understanding how to score big hundreds. At the moment, they're in their 40s. I'm still not happy, but we'll get there. And that's what's exciting. What's exciting is growth and seeing that people are going to be in certain positions. But also the reality check of, I am the national team coach. I'm not the development manager. And part of my job is to get results. So balancing that growth of those youngsters and getting out from the experienced players what is needed to make sure that we get success on the short term, but there's also long-term sustainability of that success.
Attaining the ODI status, is this mission possible?
It is mission possible. I'm a believer, and I have to say I feel a lot more positive after the Namibia trip regarding that, because as I said to you, talent wise we've got it. It's a matter of making sure that discipline and consistency grow, and that's a controllable process we can go through. And I'm a believer that we can be an we will be an ODI status.
So what's the current game? What's going on
now
with the current
game? Yeah, the clans are we're playing a lot of internal games. We're trying to get two or three. Unfortunately, with the lack of facilities we have in the country, our under-19s also have to prepare. The ladies' team are going to Rwanda in a couple of days' time. So there's a lot of demand on the facilities we have. But as the clans, we're carrying on. We're building on the process. We're putting one brick at a time and making sure that our foundations are solid.
Earlier this week, UCS confirmed the appointment of the women's coach, the national team coach, which is Kabaja. What's your view on that?
Yes, Raja, I have spoken. We've obviously worked together now for 1 week. Passionate man who, what he's achieved in UAE cricket with setting up the ladies' structure there. And just his love of the game. I'm excited to work closely with him over the next couple of years to make sure that both our ladies' team and our men's team keep reaching new heights.
Are your plans aligned?
Yeah, I think we've had one meeting as national team coaches, including the under-19 staff, and hopefully we'll have a weekly conversation to make sure that we're all on the same page, even if we meet once a week for an hour to share ideas, because no man is an island. I think nobody has all the answers, and it's important to learn. You know, I'm looking forward to learning not only from him, and hopefully I can teach him a couple of things, but from the Bagurusis, from young guys, from everybody who's had an experience of being in this country, because I think it's important that we talk to each other, we get lessons learned, we don't repeat the same mistakes that have happened before, and we get the country forward. Ultimately, it's about making Uganda successful.
Give us an update about Franco.
Yeah, Franco has got his next appointment on the 27th of May. He did injure the shoulder badly in Namibia, so he's been out for about 6 weeks. And hopefully he goes for the scans this week, hopefully he's fully recovered and can start some training. At the moment, since Namibia, he hasn't been able to train.
But of course he'll recover. Is he still part of the national team?
Yes, he is part. He's very much part of it. You know, when I speak about experience, he has a guy who's played 25 years for his country. That is a wealth of knowledge that I can use, that the next generation can use, that everybody within the system can use and really tap into. And knowing him, how competitive he is, the kind of individual he is, I'm excited. I know that he's going to come back, and he's going to come back harder and stronger.
Okay, Coach, thank you so much for sharing your thoughts. And it's the second time here. Thank you so much for honoring the
thank you for having me.
Okay, that was the cricket friends coach Lawrence Mahatlane. Thank you guys for tuning in. Thank you so much. Till next time. See ya.